freaky. Yeah, don't get me muddy. Yeah, I'm going. I'll be calling your name.
Towards the water, and you're taking a left.
Oh man, I felt the slide right there. Yeah. We could have been doing some donuts. No, don't feel free. But see, you're always putting the puddles up on my side. I know you. Look at you. You're clear on the right. Wait, you got a part-timer. I'm blind, but I ain't that blind. Alright, go. No, there's one coming, but go.
No, hey, stop.
Okay, you go.
It's the only tree where we brought.
Oh. I would have floored it.
Alright, you're good to go.
Don't floor it, now you're gonna knock it out.
Take one of these berries, put it in its mouth, and throw it back into the ocean and say, hey, I'll catch you when you're bigger. So, yep, these are wild raspberries. We have a plethora of wild berries. Yep. I mean, I can't officially be like, eat that, but, you know.
It's just a wild
raspberry, yeah.
Not bad.
Alright, pick me one, good.
So the key, anytime you're picking a berry, is you want it to easily separate from the bush. So we have a plethora of wild berries.
It tastes like salmon.
The other idea that it gets, the reason it has the name salmon berry, is because it takes every different color of the salmon, from a light white to a pink to an orangish color and then the deep red. So salmon are an incredibly important fish out here. Have you guys learned anything about the salmon being out here?
Oh, yeah.
Every year, they'll run. run up the stream about 3 to 7 years in the ocean, depending on the species. And yeah, everything just flourishes on that salmon. Do you guys hear that bird? That is our Swainson thrush. We have a lot of different migratory birds that come up here every year. But you'll see with the salmon berry, it looks a lot like a raspberry from home, right? Mm-hmm. You can see the raspberry plant right where you're at. It sounds like that too. Alright, we can hop back in now.
Alright. I'm following you. Pretend you're driving a truck.
Yeah, nice and slow.
You got a trailer on the back of your unit. Not that big a trailer. Oh, look at the stream. It's beautiful here.
Yeah, guys, welcome to the rainforest.
Birdie. Hey, keep us on the...
Alright, you want to stop here again? I'm going to get out and show you guys some plants. Alright, so the first thing that I really love about Southeast Alaska is just the extent of moss, right?
Yeah.
So this moss here, this is called sphagnum moss. It's a general name, but there's numerous different types of species of sphagnum moss that just blanket these forests. And it's really important because you see that it hangs out here on the soil. This sphagnum can hold 16 to 26 times its weight in water. So it's grabbing on to all this water, and in that water, precious nutrients that will share with all the other plants. So in this forest, guys, I shit you not, so heavily glaciated, we have these glaciers came, carved out the landscape only to melt 10,000 years ago. Not very long when you think ecologically, yeah, right? We only have 6 inches to 2 feet of topsoil anywhere on this island. So these trees, any of these trees, their root systems only go this far down.
So
they'll all spread out, and they will actually interconnect to be able to handle these high amounts of winds. Because every couple of years we have a microburst storm that comes through the area that can exceed 100 miles per hour. Just the other day, we had 50 mile per hour gusts. So trees are always coming down. So there's no fire here in the Tongass. It's too wet, but trees are always falling. But once a tree falls in the forest and no one is around, does it make a sound, gentlemen?
Probably.
I think so. But once a tree falls, the sphagnum moss is that first plant to colonize, right? And then over time, plants will begin to grow on this log. And it's the best place for any tree, any plant to grow, is on another fallen log. We call these nursery logs. But let me see. So you see this root system over here? You see how it's very, it comes up really high?
Yeah.
That's called the stilted root system. So if you have a tree that grows on a nursery log, basically what happens is the roots make their way down, and then the tree underneath decomposes, and that's what gives you that stilted root system, because it grew on top of one of these other trees. Alright, so right here we have a plant called lady fern. Ferns are one of the oldest plants in the world. They were here before flowering plants, here before any plant that you have a small, hard seed. These are called gymnosperms. And ferns will actually reproduce with spores. But one reason that ferns are really important, this one's been nommed on. You guys see that? Probably a deer grazing.
Yeah.
But a fern in its fiddlehead stage, where it's curled up, is like the best asparagus you've ever had. So as guides, we come out here, we chop up the fiddlehead ferns, We'll fry them up in butter. Super tasty. But also, these lady ferns make excellent antiseptics. So there's this plant out here, deer fern right here, and it said it's got its name because native Alaskans at one point saw deer rubbing their heads after they lost their antlers on that plant. So then they started using it as a way to bandage themselves, a way to heal and treat wounds, that kind of stuff. But yeah, just a huge diversity of moss, huge diversity of ferns. So right here, this is a plant called skunk cabbage. Skunk cabbage in the springtime will have a really big yellow flower. It's one of the first plants to grow because it can actually produce its own heat. So I have skunk cabbage where I'm from in Illinois. I'm not from Ketchikan, I didn't tell you guys that yet. And you'll see it growing with a ring of melted snow around it.
But it's like pee-pee? That's cool.
So it gets the name skunk cabbage because it has this really rotten smell in the springtime. Mm-hmm. And that's its way to attracting pollinators. It's going to be attracted to anything that likes rotting meat or decomposing material. Beetles, flies, you know, gross bugs will come pollinate this plant. Mm. So while many of these plants are edible, this one is not. The deer and bear can eat it. Humans cannot. It has a crystalline compound called calcium oxalate. And when you chew on it, your mouth will go numb and they'll talk like that. We had a guide in my company that I worked for last year, and he was telling people about it, and they're like, eat it, come on, we'll tip you, eat it. And he ate it, and his mouth swelled for the rest of the tour. So don't eat the skunk cabbage.
Get some, because we're from...
But I had someone tell me, I had a dentist on one of my tours, and he said, oh, calcium oxalate. They're using that as a desensitizing agent in Crest toothpaste now. But guys, just get a feel for this moss here. It just blankets everything. What I like to do is just put my face in it. Give it a smell. Smell the forest, guys.
All right. Hold on, do it again.
There's no smell.
Do it again. One more time.
You do it.
Well, I'm going to do it.
Yes, I'm watching that.
Yeah. You get some.
Oh, it smells.
It smells good, doesn't it?
You didn't get no smell? Rub your shit in it.
Oh, there it is. You gotta get deep.
So they say that moss grows on the north side of the tree. You can see right here, we don't have any moss. But north is that way, so I'm a little confused myself. I don't think that moss actually grows on the north side of the tree. I think that's a myth. But, yeah, so... Right here we have our hemlock tree. And hemlock is the most prolific tree in this forest. About 50% of the forest is hemlock. It's a fast-growing, shade-tolerant, kind of understory tree. Whenever you cut down places, that hemlock's going to be the first to grow. And the hemlock is a lot of the commercial wood out here. Mm-hmm. Recently was hemlock. It has, if you guys have looked at food additives and you've seen cellulose gum, yeah. Are you guys familiar with that?
Not really.
It comes from the hemlock. So if you had a milkshake prior to 1998, you have eaten part of the tongas. It's a food additive that thickens things, right? Mm-hmm. But the hemlock was mostly used for its pulp. And so this is a national forest. You guys know the difference between national forests and national parks?
No.
So National Forest is under the Department of Agriculture, which means it's mixed-use land, which means that this area can be logged, right?
Okay.
So the hemlock, there's a lot of logging here, right?
Yeah.
And in 1998, there was a legislation change, and pretty much logging ended here in Ketchikan because of a bill called the Roadless Act that Bill Clinton created. And the Ketchikan pulp mill closed down in 1996. It's estimated that 2,000 jobs were lost. When you think we have a community of 8,000 people, it's quite a hit.
Yeah.
Oh, we do have a mosquito.
Did you bring those things?
You guys don't need bug spray. Oh, nice. Gentlemen. You guys must be Boy Scouts.
No, I did a lot of
research.
That's why I got this place.
Nice.
And I've been doing reviews, and this is an awesome review.
Yeah, so Hemlock. So, yeah.
Yeah.
2,000 jobs were lost. Ketchikan looked around. They said, hey, how the heck are we going to continue using these beautiful natural resources if we can't log them? What do you think they did?
Tourism.
Tourism, yeah. The first cruise ship came in 1999. It's been an excellent replacement industry for logging here. Kind of logging left. Tourism
came in. I thought they'd be longer than that.
Well, Alaskan cruises have been going for a while, but Ketchikan had its first cruise ship here in 99.
Okay,
yep.
Okay.
I'm not sure about anywhere else.
Yeah.
So right here, this is a type of lichen. There's a huge diversity of fungus and lichen out here, right? This lichen's called lettuce leaf lichen. And a lichen is a mutually beneficial, so both species benefit, relationship between a moss and a fungus. So it's basically like a fungus learned agriculture. It provides that substrate for the algae to grow on, and then the algae gives sugar back to the fungus, and they both coexist in their own species. Easy way to remember that,
because
you could say that the algae took a lichen to the fungi. Whoa, what the heck is this? Huge mushrooms!
By these shrooms.
Yeah, man, these are shelf mushrooms called bear's bread. So, here, bend down over here with me.
You bend down because we get a picture for me.
So, you guys see, native Alaskans would use this to write messages to each other.
That's cool.
What are your initials, gentlemen?
MDM.
M. D.
No, B as in boy.
B. And C.
A. M.
I'm gonna write a heart around it.
Right.
No, I'm just kidding, guys. Yeah, so this is called bear's bread. It's a shelf mushroom. What kind of tree do you think it grows on?
Wooden tree?
Dead ones and wooden ones.
Okay.
You're absolutely right.
But is that a good mushroom?
You can't eat it.
Okay.
But people will say that bears eat it before going into hibernation to clog up their digestive system, which is a type of plug, you know, so they don't have to eat it. And then they'll eat the skunk cabbage to clear out their digestive systems in the summer. Another type of lichen. Remember, I said a lichen is a fungus and an algae. It's called old man's beard. And lichens are typically really good. Oh, you've
seen
that?
It, but we haven't felt it.
Yeah, so typically lichens are really good indicators of air quality. Old man's beard is no exception. It needs a really clean air in order to grow. And you'll see it prosper out here in the Tongass National Forest.
Smells good.
Everything smells good out here, doesn't it, man? Even the bear's poop smells good in the Tongass.
Oh, thank you. I need a beard. Hey.
Hey, dude, it looks pretty good on you. Yeah, so wherever you see that, just remember we've got some of the cleanest air in the world.
I know.
So this right here is Sitka spruce. So really the three trees that dominate this forest is that hemlock, the western red cedar, and the Sitka spruce. So this spruce is one of those slower growing trees, and it'll slowly make its way to the top of the canopy. And actually the tips of the spruce are edible, and they're jam-packed with vitamin C. I would just say right on the other side of the trail there.
Okay, we'll wait.
Huh?
What do you mean?
Just right there. Yeah, just find a tree, any tree, really. How about it, Chris? Is this your first time getting into the rainforest?
Yeah.
Nice.
I've been into national parks, but usually they're pretty small. Or the one down in Texas, South Texas.
Okay.
It kind of sucks.
Does it?
It's nothing but desert.
Right.
Yeah.
Just like the levels of green out here are pretty astounding. So many different shades of green. bunch of topsoil and then they hit rock. Doesn't matter that it's raining when you had such a beautiful sight.
Alright, now that he's getting a little cleaned up, I'd love to show you guys another really interesting plan. Okay, you're good, man. Hey, this tour is about you guys.
You didn't get a picture of me pinned, did you?
Yeah, I did. Oh, we got so many pictures. There's a lot of pointing, a lot of laughing.
Well, yeah, it's all right.
So right here, you guys see these little objects growing out of the tree? Kind of
yeah.
This tree right here? That's a parasitic plant called dwarf mistletoe. So basically what happens is it takes about 3 to 5 years to mature. And when it does, there are these pressure-filled seed pods that'll burst, shooting up to 60 miles per hour and going up to 40 feet out. And they're really sticky seeds, and then they get lodged in a tree, maybe in a hole created by a woodpecker, and they will grow into the tree and tap into the vascular system or the nutrient highway of the tree, start sucking out all those nutrients. So another name for it is witch's broom. You guys can see why it would take that name.
Yeah.
But they really like to target the hemlock. Because of the sweet sap of the hemlock, there's a red-breasted sapsucker, which creates holes. And then that's the perfect place for that dwarf mistletoe to grow in. So you'll see it spreading around. Let's see. We got one there. And basically what you see is that area is being flooded with nutrients, and that's why it's growing in that weird shape. The plant is actually inside that section of the tree, and that growth is in response to it. Oh, here we go. We got a red alder right here, guys. So, red alder is a really important tree because after an area is logged or after an area is blown down, this red alder will regrow. And just like soybeans or any type of legumes, it's a nitrogen fixator. So it takes nitrogen from the atmosphere and puts it into the soil via its roots, preparing for future growth to follow it. But once again, guys, I want you to remember that these trees are growing on this much topsoil. And then it's just bare rock. So there's not very much nutrients that's in here. I mean, let's see, what's this one?
Ah! I knew it.
You're in a phase, man.
I'm on drugs.
Me too.
I'm on drugs right now.
We've got a plant right here. This is called deer's heart or false lily of the valley. This is another edible one, a lot like spinach, or vitamin B and vitamin A. This is also something I like to take out and put on my sandwiches.
Really?
Yeah. There's one plant I want to show you guys that I thought was up here. I guess it's back here. Yeah. Oh, you guys have dogwoods in Texas?
I don't know.
This is a type of dwarf dogwood called bunch berry. This has edible berries in late summer.
I'm from New Mexico, so we don't have plants there. We just got mesquite bushes. That's it.
Yeah, I'm from Houston. He's from New Mexico.
Oh. Ow. All
right, here we go.
Oh shit! This is a deja vu moment right here.
Huh?
A deja vu.
Yeah. It's like we've been here before.
I know there's probably our initials under there.
Alright, so you guys see that plant right there?
The bushy one?
This one with the fan-shaped leaves?
Yeah, yeah.
That's called Devil's Club, and it's full of these really gnarly thorns because it has something to protect. It's a plant that's related to ginseng. It's in the family. And you can harvest that root there, and it has numerous medical benefits. Western science is just looking into it now, but it can be used as a salve for arthritis or joint pain or any of that kind of stuff. It can also be brewed into a tea. And that tea is good for colds or flus. Pretty much the native Alaskans use it for everything. But the hunters, right, this tea has this very strong taste. And the hunters will drink that tea and take in this bitter taste
soon they take on the smell of that bitter Devil's Club flavor and lose their human scent to cloak themselves in the forest.
Cool. Huh. That's cool.
Yeah, so welcome to the rainforest, guys.
You know a lot about it.
We've got an incredible diversity of plants out here. Alright, so when we think of a city that gets a lot of rain in the U.S., what's a city that we think about?
Portland, Oregon.
Seattle. I don't know the precipitation of Portland. But Seattle gets 38 inches of rain a year, right?
Yeah.
In order for an ecosystem to be considered a rainforest, it needs 55. Here in Ketchikan, you guys want to take a guess at how much rain?
128.
You, sir, are the closest without going over. We get 158 inches of rain a year. 14.
See, feet. I knew there was 8 in there. See?
Yeah, you guys both threw out that 8 number.
Now we just need one more person there and we can get that lottery ticket.
If Houston keeps up its rain thing, it might be getting about as much rain. It's been,
You guys have been getting flooded, huh?
Yeah.
So this is a really good example of these nursery logs. You see how this tree fell? First plant to grow is this moss, and it holds on to all those nutrients, sharing it with these other plants. We got lady fern, we've got the young hemlock, we've got the dwarf dogwood or bunch berry, and we've got that deer fern right over there, or deer heart. So this is the best place for a tree to grow. So eventually this hemlock is going to make its way up to the canopy, and that log will decompose beneath it and its root systems will make its way down, and that's what gives you the silted root system that looks a lot like that. Mm-hmm. Once again, these roots also interconnect so they can be more stable. Cool.
My pants. Probably getting in.
You guys ready?
Yeah.
I'm ready, Freddy. Ready, Freddy. Alright. Watch this out over here.
Yeah.
You trying to kill me?
Yep.
Watch that tree now. There you go. Then you got a trailer behind you.
Yeah, good driving, Tex. I can actually call you Tex. Yeah, so guys, right here, this is a historic salmon ladder that we're looking at. So basically what they would do, yep, you want to keep going straight up here along this fence line. But basically, oh hey guys, actually, you want to stop here? I'll talk about this cedar tree.
Whoa.
The majestic red cedar. Here, break this up in your hands and give it a smell. Just roll it up like this.
Oh my
gosh. We are at the northern extent of this red cedar. This is my favorite tree, guys. The cedar is super cool. First of all, it can be made into chests because that oil is incredibly insect repellent. So any insects that might be trying to get into your clothing chest can protect it. But really important tree to the native Alaskans. The bark grows in these long strips, so they would harvest the bark by like sticking a harder piece of wood up it, getting these strips of bark harvesting that bark, getting strips of up to 15 feet. And what they would do is they would weave these strips of bark into making watertight baskets. Yes, actually baskets that are watertight, and rain gear. That was the two primary uses out of it. They would put on like cool hats, jackets, all weaved out of the bark of the Western Red Cedar. It's very waterproof, very rot resistant.
Huh.
But the Western Red Cedar will naturally hollow out over time and grows like a corkscrew, and that's an adaptation it has to the high amounts of wind. So since it grows like a corkscrew when those winds come, it will wind and unwind in that wind. Also a good stretch before going hiking, of course.
That's one for me. Oh man, that's what I am.
Actually feels pretty good, guys. You might want to join me in that.
Oh, I'm fine.
But because these trees hollow out, the native Alaskans, they'll take a fallen cedar and they'll burn off the top, chisel off the inside, and out of a single tree, they'll build a canoe.
Yeah, I think, yeah, yeah, canoe.
Canoes as far south as California.
Hmm.
So really important trees. Later on in the tour, we're going to be looking at some totem poles. All the totem poles are made out of cedar.
Make sure they last.
Yeah. All right. Let's,
we're going to get out of here.
We're going to get.
Wait for me, Christopher. I know you'd want to leave me behind.
Yep, totally.
I know you would. You'd leave me behind in a second.
Yep, I'm just going to let our chef know that we're almost there.
As we're going uphill? Oh, hold on a while. I got to get the video up here.
We'll get the video.
We're going forward, by God. Look at him. Look at him. Uh-huh. All right, I like her. I'm glad you come on this trip with me.
Hey, I'm glad that you guys picked me to be your tour guide.
We.
You seem to know a lot.
I'm kind of a nerd.
I like that. That's awesome.
Games.
Oh, yeah? What games do you like?
Oh, everything.
I play a lot of Magic the Gathering.
I do not play that, but my best friend got me into Dungeons & Dragons.
Oh, nice, man. I play a little D&D. Yep, so this way, and then we're going to be busting a right onto this trail.
You've done a lot of research and education on this stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what? Last summer I was a hiking guide. This summer I'm mostly out on the water, so I'm always happy to get back into the forest.
Hmm.
So here we have more of that alder tree. I'm not familiar with this flower, guys. Look at that nice pretty white flower. But I am familiar with these other plants.
Well, now why you gonna get me in the water? No, I'm fine.
This plant right here with these red flowers is called salal. You see it has these very glossy leaves. And salal will have a really nice plump purple berry in the midsummer. But you guys see right there, those salmon berries, they take on that orange color as well. Once again, kind of every color that the salmon takes, the salmon berry will emulate. And then once again, we have our cedar tree right here. And you guys remember what this tree is?
Deer heart.
This is our alder tree. So that's our nitrogen fixator.
Okay, well, that's what I'm saying.
Normally it has four leaves, but it'll lose these two leaves when it flowers and grow four additional ones. Hmm. All right, that's fine.
There's one.
side. Climb up this tree. So how long are you guys playing D&D? That's a sap sucker that creates those holes. It's really important ecologically because all these birds that follow the sap sucker will then have access to the sweet sap of the hemlock. Furthermore, smaller birds like the nuthatch can then create nests out of holes that are started by the sap sucker. So without this sap sucker, so many different types of birds wouldn't be able to eat, wouldn't be able to find homes. So just really filling this ecological niche, good friend of all these other birds. You'll see that the sap sucker will never go all the way around the tree. It only sticks to an isolated section, and that's because if he went all the way around that tree will die. But for a while, that sweet sap in the hemlock was used as an alternative sweetener in the 80s.
You to get them leaves up there in your face, by God.
All right, now you're going to take a right here. All
right. I slow it and make it so nobody coming. You know I'm driving.
Yeah.
I'm the fast food driver.
I learned to drive in Houston.
So is this land here owned by?
This is actually owned by a Native Alaskan corporation called Cape Fox. So the Tlingit people, they decided, hey, we're not going to be on a reservation, we want to be incorporated, which meant that they were given land and they were given monetary benefits, and they can do whatever they want with this land. That means logging, developing, whatever. Of course, just like pretty much any other First Nation people, they didn't necessarily get the best deal in dealing with the U.S.
I've got a t-shirt like that. It says, trust the, it's an Indian.
Yeah.
And it says, trust the trust the government, ask an Indian.
Right, yeah.
Ask a Native.
Ask a Native American, yeah. I got that. I should have wore that shirt today.
So, yeah, they did get a better deal than a lot of the Native Americans, but not necessarily. That doesn't necessarily mean that they got a great deal. Oh, God, you got some blue skies ahead of us.
There's an eagle.
Oh, there's some eagles soaring above. Oh, and right here, too. Yeah, so these eagles, they're really big. They stay here year-round. They've got about a 6-foot wingspan. And the females are up to 18 pounds. The males up to 16. So they're big birds. But, you know, Benjamin Franklin originally didn't want the bald eagle to be...
of the turkey.
Yeah, right. Because he was able to make a scavenger our national bird. Take a left right here. Beautiful view, guys.
Wow.
Yeah, just come all the way to that ledge over there. Find us some dry ground to step on into.
Right over there. Watch that tree.
What's the Raven's favorite Star Trek character? What's the Raven's favorite Star Trek character? Spock!
You're not gonna say that, but I didn't want to be wrong.
You didn't want to take my joke?
No, I didn't want to be wrong now.
Hey, you're always right. You're our visitor here. All right, yeah. So, guys, what we're looking at here is this first body of water. This is the east channel of the Tongass Narrows. This is one of the busiest commercial waterways in the world. Because everything here in town has to come in via the barges. So we have some pretty expensive food here. Like I was saying, every bus, every morsel of food comes in through the barges. And that's one reason why it's really important to a lot of people who live here to have a boat. Not only do you have to get off the island so you don't go crazy, but also you can supplement your income by catching salmon and halibut, eating your own fish that you catch. Yeah. And they are the bountiful waters. Ketchikan's, we call ourselves the salmon capital of the world. We have some of the most diverse and productive salmon streams than anywhere else in Southeast Alaska. And the fishermen here are champions of it. They tax themselves, they regulate themselves, they ensure that Alaska seafood is some of the most high quality and some of the most sustainable seafood in the world. Right over there we have Penick Island, this first island that we're looking at. Uh-huh. Penick Island is just a short boat ride to town, so you have this nice kind of dispersed Southeast Alaskan lifestyle, but then you're able to cross the East Channel and come and live or come work or shop in town. But starting at the age of 14, kids can actually start operating their boats. So they will begin crossing that channel on their own in a kayak or a small boat called a skiff, coming over to school every day. It'd be a pretty cool commute, huh? Penick.
Oh, place of panic. I get that a lot.
So then, over behind Penick Island is an island called Gravina, and Gravina is where our airport sits. So if you fly into Ketchikan, you go into Ketchikan International Airport. It's called International because it also services Canada. But you have to take a ferry across. It's about $6 every 30 minutes, the ferries on one side or the other. And for a while, they were thinking about building a bridge. But then they found, hey, we've got these 100-mile-per-hour winds every couple years. The cruise ships have to go under this. The float planes have to go over it. It's just going to be way too expensive. So they did it. But there was a large controversy around a certain vice presidential candidate. You guys are familiar with Sarah Palin and the Bridge to Nowhere? Remember that Bridge to Nowhere?
Yeah, she
That's
promised.
Nowhere right there.
Okay, yeah, she promised. She promised to build it and then...
She took away the funding. Yeah, but she didn't make the promise. She made the promise, and then she was elected as governor, and she said sorry. All right, so right here, you guys see, once again, these mountains take a very rounded shape. With the mist rising above the mountains, that's a very common view of the Tongass, and really part of its charm. But you can see how a lot of these trees are taking on that light green color. That's because it's decorated with that old man's beard.
Hmm.
But as I was saying on the map, you guys see how we have this intrusion of mountains and water, right? Because these glaciers came in, they carved out these deep valleys. And then once they receded, the ocean flooded in. And that's what gives you these really deep channels between the mountains.
How deep is the water over here?
So this channel there where you see the white caps, maximum depth 600 feet.
I was wondering, because if they can't build a bridge, maybe 100 feet.
Oh, yeah, that's a lot. It's a lot of rock you'd have to go through.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really windy out there. We also give Zodiac tours. All our tours are canceled today. So that's the tour that I normally give, is I give a tour out on the water. I'm happy to be there.
Well, thank you. We appreciate you coming.
This
has been a wonderful tour so far. Now, we ain't finished yet, so I don't know. We might have to give him a bed. That motherfucker.
Don't screw it up, Lewis. Don't screw it up. No. So this is the bedrock that we have around here. It's a bedrock called schist. Let's see if I can find a good one here. So schist, it looks a lot like shale because you see how it breaks in these even layers.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a metamorphic rock, meaning that it's been cooked. So you hit it together and it kind of sounds like ceramic, right? But then you'll see the shiny thing. The shininess comes from it being cooked, but we also have a pyrite or fool's gold in the rocks.
Yeah, my grandma over there. I guess in Colorado somewhere.
Yeah, some moss.
She found a bunch of that pyrite.
Yeah.
She was loading the truck bed full of pyrite. She thought she was
gonna. Pools go on for a reason, right?
And she was gonna.
Oh, our eagle's singing for us.
Here, put them in
your
pocket.
We got another eagle right here, guys.
Oh, come. Oh, is that another eagle singing?
Yeah. So you hear in movies the eagle goes, caw, but
yeah.
That is actually not the call of the eagle. That's the call of the red-tailed hawk. This is what eagles sound like. They kind of sound like seagulls.
Oh, yeah, probably.
All right, I got one more overlook to show you guys.
Okay, let's kick it. Because I want to be able to see what's going to happen.
Yeah, so the Tongass National Forest, which is all of southeast Alaska, essentially. Alaska is like 95% state and, or 95% federally owned, 4% state owned, and then 1% privately owned. And most of that 1% is owned by the Native Alaskan corporations. It's a very small percentage owned, you know. Of course, a very small piece of that 1% is owned by people who just have a single home, right? But Tongass National Forest, which is what comprises the majority of southeast Alaska, is the largest stand of temperate forest in the world. It accounts for...
what is that?
Yep, so right over here, if you just want to get a look at this little forest.
I thought that was an animal. What was that? What is that?
We just turn around here, but I just wanted you guys to get a look at all these trees here. It's a gorgeous view with the mist pulling over. All the beard. Can you hear eagle?
This is purtiful.
Purtiful. Yeah, so the Tongass National Forest accounts for 15% of the biomass. So many trees here, and if you include the salmon in on it, which is this wonderful influx of nutrients that comes every year, it has more biomass than the tropical rainforest. Or an accent alint.
Indeed.
You got that one?
Yeah.
I did.
Okay. Which way are we going?
We're heading back the way we came.
All right. All
right.
All right.
We're going to go look at totem poles.
Yeah. All right. They changed the tour.
Beautiful view of the water right here, guys.
Dang.
Doesn't get much better, eh?
Cool. Oh, Lordy. Did you bring this for battery?
No, I didn't. I should have grabbed it out of the bag, huh?
I thought I'd ask you, but
no, you did.
Since you don't love me no more.
Oh, I'm glad you finally understand.
Yeah.
Thank you.
much anymore. I used to play a lot of Diablo 2 and World of Warcraft and StarCraft and be a real Blizzard kind of player, but I don't have any machines to run it on. I don't have the internet at my house. I try and spend most of my time outside these days, but still really like to play Magic the Gathering, and we're going to be starting the D&D campaign here pretty soon. I was told to think of a character, but I have no storyline, so...
A friend and I thought of one that we were going to do. We were going to all make sorcerers and make it to where it was... I forgot the word he used, but you'd roll 1d4, and if you rolled 1 through 3, you had to do the magic surge, the random thing that you had to roll for, the d100,
find out
what magic you accidentally do.
Oh my gosh, nice. So kind of like a Clefairy's metronome. Alright, so, let's see, we keep going here. Let's hope I don't get us lost, eh, team?
Man, please. Don't scare me like that. We got a bunch of tours in Seattle. We can't miss the ship.
That's what we can do in Seattle when we get there.
What?
We can do the underground.
Yeah.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Well, I tried to get him the...
Alright, so here's your right here. You want to go very slowly down here. Nice turn, Chris.
Oh, boy. What's wrong with you? It's like driving in Oklahoma.
Let's see, what else do we have that's awesome around here, gentlemen? Look at how big those skunk cabbages get. Don't continue going throughout the summer.
Goodness gracious. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Here, actually, let's go pull up to that next bridge and I'll point out some other plants.
Oh, thank you, Christopher.
You're welcome.
Whee! Now it's time to do a wheelie. Do a wheelie, 360. Whee! Watch out, we got a rider in the back, Christopher.
I'm trying.
Hey, you're doing a good job, traction. Man. I appreciate you going nice and slow.
Oh!
Alright, yeah, this is a fine place to stop. We'll talk about some more.
My two man, two man.
So this right here,
okay, oh yeah.
It has some berries, but they're not edible. Not much else that's noteworthy about that. But here we have over here.
Thank you.
wanted to have a cabin in a place like this and stay in it for about a month and then go to civilization for a month and then come back here every month. We got unlimited data, but
your phones can't give you a hotspot?
No, because we have unlimited data.
They stick you with that.
Yeah. Huh? Unlimited data, but you can't use your hotspot. Maybe you can take your SIM card and put it in the old phone, which doesn't have a lock on it.
Yeah, but it's the Verizon.
Well, so. Well, yeah, it's a different system. Well, you do the 1 terabyte a month.
Oh my god. Have they even beaten you guys while on that cruise ship?
Oh, like, yeah.
Oh, so good.
This cruise has been good.
Once you get to the restaurant in the back, it's amazing. They have stuff back there that they have like a daily menu, and there's an appetizer for it with stuff that you usually wouldn't try. I got to try fish eggs, stuff like that. The texture was horrible. Didn't taste too bad.
I like the texture of fish eggs.
I can't take it.
I couldn't do
the tiny small red ones, the roe.
I think so. And they had ox tongue.
Yeah, I couldn't take ox tongue.
Oh, that's weird.
Sushi for the first time.
It kind of.
Do you like it?
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big fan of sushi, but I traveled through Japan once and ate a lot of sushi there.
Japan?
You want to go to Japan?
Yeah, man. You know what? If you get a college degree, are you going to school?
Yeah,
I mean, you get a 4-year degree, you can go teach English in Japan. Really,
there you go.
It's a really good way to do it. And I have a lot of friends who travel through East Asia, and all you need is a bachelor's degree in anything you want to do. So, hey,
I wish they did that.
Ever looking for a summer job between schooling, Southeast Labs is a great place to come and be a tour guide. I came out here last summer. Oh, guys, we can see the water from here. See the ocean.
Yeah, I'm getting that.
Oh, wow.
We're going to be getting to an even better view of that.
All right. It's got the park.
We can handle that.
And you see this light green color. Oh, wait. It said you cannot shake hands with the spruce. So be very careful because it's very spiky. Whereas the hemlock, very soft. You shake hands with the hemlock. The spruce, you cannot.
What do you mean shake hands?
Grip is like...
Let me see.
Don't do that to
that.
Well,
he's not a spruce.
Oh, yeah. Ow! Do it.
No.
I'm going to poke a hole in you. That's neat.
Yeah, actually, so we have all three plants here.
Yeah.
This is our cedar, yeah. This is our hemlock.
And
this
is
our spruce.
This is
the one that smells good on your hand, Daddy. The one that they use the wood.
Yeah, but isn't this the one they also use for insects?
Yes.
Let's see smell.
I can't tell if I'm smelling this or if I'm smelling that because you rubbed your hands.
Well, obviously you smelled this because this ain't that.
It smells similar though.
It does smell similar. That's
this kind of smells similar. That smell of that cedar though, man.
This smells like cedar.
Yeah.
So any other island you went to, any other stop you went to, you won't find the cedar. We're at the northern extent of this cedar. But it's interesting because this area, of course, the glaciers went away so recently that
so do you think the global warming is natural, or do you think it's man-made?
Can I get into it? You're talking to a scientist here. What do you think I think?
I think it's natural.
Yeah, exactly. Throughout the years, you know, we have seen periods of glaciation, and we have seen periods of melting, and you can see that by levels of oxygen, O16 and O18 isotopes in the ocean.
Yeah.
Because O16 evaporates easier, so when you have more O18, it's warmer. And then when you have more O16, you know, it's colder and more is locked up in the glaciers. Whatever, that's a lot of details.
Sounds good.
But, so we do see this trend going on. Yeah. But what we're seeing is that, so you guys know the planet Venus, right? And Venus is super hot because of greenhouse gases, carbon being a huge one. Right. So throughout the years, we have, carbon has been deposited in the Earth via fossil fuels. What happens is you have a swamp, something dies in it, a plant or an animal, and it cannot decompose and it gets buried beneath the Earth. That carbon is then captured from the atmosphere and placed into the ground in the form of coal and oil. So then you go and you burn that up, and we're sending carbon back into the atmosphere at a very quick rate. And we're seeing that carbon is a greenhouse gas, right? So it keeps heat in. So we're seeing that it is raising the temperature. And we're reversing this trend of cooling over time. So I would say that it is a natural phenomenon, but we are certainly speeding it up.
We're speeding it up, yeah. That's cool. Thank you.
Yeah. Good little thing.
Well, I'm not a fanatic.
Oh, yeah.
Because you said about moving north.
Right. And, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. This place is a great example of how climates change over time.
That's pretty cool. Don't hit them.
Prepare yourselves.
Hey, now, come on. You jackass.
You wouldn't be your son if he wasn't driving you into plants, right?
Yeah. Asshole.
All right, take it right here, Chris.
Right there. We're going forward now.
Oh, we got another kid over here.
All right. Whee!
Yep, so if you want to pull up this way, and you can just park your Jeep right in this little entrance over here. Hey! Hey, guys! Yeah, that's a fine place.
Alright.
This is Jen. She's been cooking up pancakes for you guys all morning. Jen, I see you got a little helper.
I do. This is my son, Tate.
Oh,
look at Tate. Look at Tate. Look at Tate.
So what are we serving up here today?
Hot water for cider or hot chocolate or hot tea if you'd like, and then I'll have these pancakes off, and then you can make some s'mores if you'd like. Sound good?
Thank you.
Sound like camping.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
I'm gonna get
it's coffee.
It's no, it's not.
Oh, hot water, okay.
Yeah.
Is it spring water?
Huh?
Is it spring water?
No, it's just from our city water.
Yeah, we got water from the waterfall.
From the glacier.
Oh, did you? Yeah, we're gonna have a glacier up here.
We walked 20 minutes to it and then had a bottle that we filled up with the water.
That's amazing.
And it's halfway gone now. We're supposed to take some with us.
But these, oh, you guys are just drinking hot, it's just hot water?
Yeah.
Hey, you guys want some tea to put in there or some chocolate? There you go.
Yeah, there's some chocolate and this is coffee here.
These guys love dry climates themselves.
Where are
y'all from?
I'm from New Mexico.
And I'm from Houston.
So you're loving the rain.
He's not. I am. It never rains.
I'm loving the rain that's not completely flooding roads.
Yeah. So, who had chocolate?
Right here.